Coming up next, coverage of the 125th birthday celebration of Nation magazine entitled The State of the Union, sponsored in part by the University of California Graduate School of Journalism. The featured speaker for the event is Gore Vidal, author of some 30 books and a contributing editor to Nation magazine.
On first emerging from prison, the man said this: "Comrades and fellow South Africans, I greet you all in the name of peace, democracy, and freedom for all. I stand here before you not as a prophet, but as a humble servant of you, the people. Your tireless and heroic sacrifices have made it possible for me to be here today. I therefore place the remaining years of my life in your hands." I think it's appropriate those words launch this. Much of this evening is deliberately unscripted. So forgive any kind of wackiness or confusion that comes out. There's photographing is okay, but please no flash bulbs. That can be a problem. Thank you. First off, I want to give real quick thanks to a few people and get that. Cody's Books, the bookstores involved, Black Oak, City Lights, Modern Times, Kepler's, Printers Inc., and Walden Pond, and very special thanks to Tom Goldstein, Dean of the Graduate School of Journalism here, that really made this possible, and to the Express, and to you. Among the waning few minds not rendered comatose by the cathode ray, the Nation and KPFA, thank you. Here's our program. My name is Bob Baldock, and I'm the servant of ceremonies here. No one in this company who was sane could consider themselves a master of ceremonies. A few words about the people who are here, much of which you already know. I'm going to introduce them all briefly. There's not going to be a whole lot of in-between times on some of this. First, let's meet in the fuchsia blouse, Barbara Ehrenreich. A writer who appears, as you probably know, in Ms. and Mother Jones, the author of Fear of Falling, and a book called The Worst Years of Our Lives. I look back at the 80s. I hope that this is not an optimistic vision. She's also co-chair of the Democratic Socialists of America. In the cobalt blue, Eva Patterson, Eva Jefferson Patterson. Eva is assistant director of the San Francisco Lawyers Committee for Urban Affairs, and she's chair of several, perhaps all, of the major boards and coalitions for civil rights in the area. Someone said a one-sentence remark about her that has to be repeated. They said, if she's not on your side, change sides. Larry Bensky. National Affairs Correspondent for Pacifica, writer for The Nation, The Bay Guardian, The Express. Still able to qualify as an éminence gris, but an authentic natural resource. Then we come to Molly Ivins. Columnist for the Dallas Times Herald and for the very excellent magazine The Progressive, sometimes for the New York Times, not so excellent. A Nation contributing editor, and as you'll find out, a very saucy Texas barbecuer. Victor Novasky. Editor since 1978 of The Nation, something that I consider a really extraordinary credential. And an author of several very good books indeed. I just finished reading Naming Names, recommend it. Now we're gonna lead off this evening. There is no written program, and I'm not apologizing for that. If there was, we would have torn them all up anyway. The program kept shifting in May yet again. The anticipation is that Mr. Vidal will come, and he's going to deliver, as promised, his State of the Union address. Following that, not very long after that, with just enough pause for you to gasp, and there will be a half round table. And as promised to these good people, the way this is seen is that Mr. Vidal will be, in this circumstance, Miles Davis. They will all riff around him and what he says. The idea behind that is that no one comes in with preset speeches and that something happens that otherwise would never conceivably have happened. Gore Vidal, if he's not our best and one of the best of the century, it's hard to imagine who is. We know him as an author, an extraordinary prose stylist, over a wide range of books. But what I would like to give special credit for, and I think this evening wants that, in a country that seems almost without writers, particularly those of any serious international renown, articulating a social conscience, standing up behind things. When the Rushdie affair broke, there was a tremendous amount of dust kicked up by writers leaping onto horseback. And it's as though for a great many of them, it suddenly occurred to them that words perhaps have meanings, that they extend beyond intellectual land and reader land, and they have meanings out there in the rest of the real world. Can you hear me all right? Thank you. Turn up your aid. Think of the things Mr. Vidal has spoken up for and against. The religious right, the religious. Gay rights. never popular things, increasingly part of the public discourse, but not for a very long time. And who else has spoken out at great risk for Palestinian rights? A few weeks ago in East Jerusalem, I was having a discussion with an Israeli human rights worker and an Israeli peace activist. They said, when I mentioned Gor Vidal and that this event was going to take place, tell him, please. He speaks for us. He speaks for the best of what we are. So please welcome him for the work he's done, for how he's done it, and for what he keeps on doing, Mr. Gor Vidal.
Well, as the great communicator would say, they didn't break the mold either. That was a very nice introduction, but I see that I am billed as our greatest living something or other, but I think that my most cloudy and proudest trophy is a little right-wing magazine, The American Spectator, said that in the 1980s, I was the greatest pain in the ass in the United States. Now we begin the 90s. I speak for the nation, as always, but specifically for the mag as well. My subject is the State of the Union, and I can only say of that that no matter how bad things are, I always think of those immortal words of Spiro Agnew. For all its faults, the United States is still the greatest nation in the country. They didn't break that mold either. I'm going to read this, but I will look up from time to time to give an air of spontaneity to these remarks. I can still wing things, but I don't fly very high. Let me touch on some highlights in our past and some darkness in our present, and let us employ past light to dispel present darkness. And if somebody doesn't dispel that noise, what is it? I gather it's a hearing aid. I was too tactful to say so, but someone put it down. Read my lips. Thank you, Thomas Jefferson, this is where it all begins. Some ambitious American colonists, as we approached the 4th of July, most of them were lawyers, I'm afraid, wanted to separate from England. Although there were no polls in those days, as far as we can tell, most people did not care one way or another whether they paid tax to London or to Boston, or preferably to nobody at all. But lawyers are not like other people. They are, as Henry II said, perpetrators of quarrels, makers of slogans, no taxation without representation. Lawyer Jefferson, they said, write us a declaration. You know, something high-toned, preferably 18th century. He did. All by himself, he created the idea of the American Revolution as opposed to the less glamorous and certainly less noble business of who pays tax to whom. We would together constitute a new nation founded upon life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You may well whistle. The first two foundation stones were familiar, if vague. After all, what is liberty? Liberty from what? Liberty from everyone else? From decent opinion? From accountability? That debate goes on. But the notion of freedom from tyranny is an ancient one, and everyone thinks he knows what Jefferson meant, including Dreamy Tom himself. But the pursuit of happiness is the real joker in the deck. To this day, no one is really sure just what Jefferson meant. But I suppose what he had in mind was government will leave each citizen alone to develop as best he can in a tranquil climate to achieve whatever it is that his heart desires with a minimum of distress to the other pursuers of happiness. This was a revolutionary concept in 1776, and it still is. With a single phrase, Jefferson had upped the ante and made our republic, in name at least, more human than any other. Eventually, we freed ourselves from England, thanks to the French fleet. At the end of the struggle, there was George Washington and hardly anybody else except the lawyers. They were excited by the prospect of a new nation with new laws and an exciting, complex judiciary in need of powerful advocates and prosecutors and interpreters. Henry II's nightmare came true in a highly legalistic constitution that excluded from citizenship women, slaves, Native Americans, and the poor. The Constitution, as opposed to the Declaration, was designed to serve those white men of property who feared monarchy almost as much as they feared democracy. Hence our famous checks and balances that make it certain that no one can ever become king while the people at large are effectively excluded from government. That is why today, unlike most first world countries, we have many elections, but no politics. Then the second revolutionary note was struck Although the Founding Fathers were, to a man, natural conservatives, there were enough Jeffersonian-minded pursuers of happiness among them to realize that so lawyerly a republic would probably act as a straitjacket to those of an energetic nature. So to ensure the rights of each to pursue happiness, the Bill of Rights was attached to the Constitution. In theory, henceforward, no one need fear the tyranny of either the state or of the majority. Certain of our rights, like freedom of speech, were said to be inalienable. But a significant minority has never accepted so much freedom for so many. That is why, from 1776 to the present day, the real ongoing drama of our republic has been the relentless attack of the prosperous few upon the rights of the restless many. Certainly, the current Supreme Court is dedicated to the removal or alienation of as many of our inalienable rights as possible on the specious ground that what the founders did not spell out as a right is not a right at all, but some sort of unpatriotic, un-American activity. We are told that since the Constitution nowhere says that a citizen has the right to have sex with another citizen or to take drugs or to OD on cigarettes or, as the nation is now doing, on sugar, the founders did not license him to do any of these things, or indeed anything proscribed by the prejudices of a local majority. This is a wonderfully duplicitous argument, and our current court plays the dumb Dora game with real skill as it goes about imposing what has always been, until now, the impossible dream of the few, a patriarchal state. What is a patriarchal state? Well, the word comes from the Latin pater, which means father, as in father knows best. It is also the origin of the word patriot, someone who serves the fatherland. Where does the notion of the father as chief of chiefs come from? Obviously, from the prehistoric evolution of those tribes, where the father was absolute in his powers over everyone else in his family. From this tribal conceit derives monotheism, the idea of a single God creator, whom we invariably depict as a man who has created at least half of us in his image. Actually, we created him, or our forefathers did. Was the United States meant to be a patriarchal society? I think the answer is no. Was the United States meant to be a monotheistic society, Christian or otherwise? The answer is no. Religion may be freely practiced here, but religion was deliberately excluded from the political arrangements of our republic. Unfortunately, the zealous few are always busy trying to make the many submit to their own religious superstitions. In the 1950s, they won a great and illegal victory over the Constitution when they were able to put the phrase, "In God we trust," on the money. They are forever trying to make us a Christian nation. Thus far, we have escaped by the skin of our teeth, the rapture of being saved. The notion of one God may give comfort to those in need of a daddy, but it reminds the rest of us that every totalitarian society based on one-man rule, descends directly from the concept of God the Father. From that notion came Hitler and Stalin, one paternal God, one paternal leader, and the rest of us are children to be told what to do. Authority is absolute, an error, as the Roman Catholic Church tells us in private. Error has no rights. Each year it is discovered with some alarm that high school students, when confronted anonymously with a Bill of Rights, neither like it nor approve of it. Our society has made them into true patriots. But not of the idea of a free society, but of a stern patriarchy, where the police have every right to arrest you for just about anything that Dad disapproves of. To me, the tragedy of the United States in this century is not the crack up of an empire we never knew what to do with in the first place, but a collapse of the idea of the citizen as someone autonomous, whose private life is not subject to orders from above. Today, hundreds of thousands of Americans are only marginally free as they undergo mandatory blood tests, urine tests, lie detector tests. Speech is theoretically free, but the true pulpit, electronic or print, is pretty much denied anyone who does not support the patriarchal state and all its misdeeds at home and abroad. It is no wonder, the story we've all read recently, that two-thirds of those citizens under 40 have no interest at all in public affairs. They know that they are helpless. They know that they are really participants in the governance of the country, that they have no role to play, and that they are simply administrative units. Where did we go wrong? I would put the time and place as the White House in 1950. Harry Truman and his advisors decided that it would be a good idea to keep the United States on a full wartime basis, even though there was no enemy anywhere on earth who could challenge us militarily or economically. So an enemy had to be invented. The dictator Stalin fitted the bill, so did atheistic and godless communism, as a rival religion. But, said a Republican senator to Truman, if you really want to waste all that money on the military, you're going to have to scare hell out of the American people. So with a lot of help from Congress and from the likes of Henry Luce, Truman did just that. The Russians are coming, he cried. We are in mortal danger. Abroad from an expanding, invincible Soviet Union. At home from anyone who dares criticize what the American government is doing to the American people. As a result, since 1950, there has been no connection between the government, which represents the nation's corporate interests, and the people at large, who are not represented at all. There is no difference between the Republican and Democratic parties, which means which means that there is no instrument whereby the people might be able to assert themselves and make known their will. Should we try a third party? Well, we did in 1968. The People's Party, as well as Peace and Freedom. Were we effective? No. Because we hadn't realized that to have a third party, you must have two other parties. We also found out that political parties, as opposed to spontaneous movements, are not possible in an oligarchy as entrenched as the one that rules us. From George Washington to George Bush, the oligarchy only grows stronger and more resilient and more oppressive. For 40 years, it amused our rulers to pretend that we were in imminent danger of destruction at the hands of a second world country called Russia, and by an ideology called communism, which is translated by the FBI and the CIA, meant anyone who dared criticize our national security state and the defense budget. Why in 1950 was the decision made that we must always be at war with someone or other forever? One reason was understandable, if mistaken. We had made our recovery from the depression of the 1930s only when the Second War put everyone to work. So rather than run the terrible risk of a free economy where General Motors would have to make something people wanted, like a car, we decided to take all the revenues, two-thirds anyway, of the federal government and put them into armaments. The second reason for our garrison state is obvious: profits for the few. There is a third reason, but I don't think anyone in 1950 was quite aware of its consequences. A garrison state, forever at war, hot or cold, is easily governed and controlled by the few. Unlike a relatively free society of the sort the founders had in mind, where the governors are accountable to the people at large and to law. Today, the neglected, ignored people have got the point. Half the electorate now sensibly refuses to vote in presidential elections. After all, was there any difference between Dukakis and Bush? Admittedly, Dukakis did not seem to mind too much if Kitty was raped by black prisoners on furlough, while Bush thought that the flag was just grand, even if it was made in Taiwan. This was all good fun. Our rulers do have a sense of fun. What? I'm not worried. This is all good fun of the kind that our governors, who gave us primetime television, think the idiots, us, will just lap up. But then it is their job to divert public attention away from the great corruption of Pentagon and SNLs and toxic waste. In the end, there was a difference, by the way, between the two. Dukakis wanted to increase the Pentagon budget by $2 billion and Bush by $4 billion. Only Jesse Jackson said that if the defense budget was not severely cut, there would be no country worth defending. But that sort of substantive politics is not allowable. So he has been demonized and trivialized and will probably join me on the American Spectator list. I think the point has now been well taken that if one wants a successful political career in the United States, the one subject that one must never address is politics. How does this small group that pays for the presidents and the congresses maintain its grip on the country? After all, if people hadn't believed falsely that Noriega was the number one drug dispenser, Panama couldn't I love that Toya, what was it, the flower they found, it was not cocaine. That was it, tamales, the word slipped me, thank you. Usually tamales is absolutely on the top of my consciousness. Anyway, if the people hadn't been conned about Noriega, Panama could not have been illegally invaded, so that Bush might not seem a wimp in the polls. Thousands of Panamanians died, as well as 23 American servicemen, of which we now learn 9 were shot by other servicemen. And there was no point to this other than the shoring up of the image of the oligarch's current spokesman, George Bush. Since, by design, I don't know, but the reading skills of the American people are the lowest in the first world. As a result, the general public is always an easy prey to manipulation by television. This means that if you want to demonize drugs or the Arabs or the Japanese, you do so openly in the media. You also do it subliminally. As a result, in the last 2 years, drugs were pushed from 10th to first place as national worry number one. Now that communism has ceased to be the unholy devil, drug pushers and users are the new enemy. My favorite was aircraft carriers are needed now, we are told, off the coast of Colombia to intercept drug exporters. And that will justify the two-thirds of the real budget once again going to the Pentagon, which will keep us clean. Actually, the government has no interest, although it has declared war on drugs, it has no interest in winning this latest war, a war that will be lost like all the other wars they have pretended to fight, because they never have an interest in winning as opposed to expensively prosecuting war. The oligarchy does not care whether the citizens make themselves sick with drugs or not. What the government wants is simple. Total control over the money, and ultimately, total control over each citizen. If this can be got by dispensing with the Bill of Rights, then that's a small price to pay for freedom. Freedom for the few, that is. In fact, the whole tone of the Reagan-Bush management is one of open hostility, contempt for our ancient rights in particular, and for the people in general. Today, the poor, as Mr. Bush might put it, are in deep doo-doo. I don't know where he learned to talk like that. But. The rich are fed up with the poor, and if the poor don't shape up, the rich just aren't going to take it anymore. Meanwhile, real problems, as opposed to imaginary ones, are deflected with irrelevant answers or downright lies. Social Security? Don't worry. We've already invested your trust fund in government bonds. What happens if the government goes broke? Well, we may not be number one in quality of life. Actually, we're number 19. But life in Mexico is a lot worse. I mean, if it wasn't, they wouldn't want to live here, would they? Why can't Americans be as well educated and looked after in the health department as the Swedes? Because we don't want to commit suicide the way they do, that's why. You have a good society and you want to kill yourself. Everybody knows that. Schools, come on, let's be serious. If we hadn't put all your money in military hardware, in planes that cannot fly, and nuclear weapons that cannot be used without killing us first, Gorbachev would never have cried uncle. If you think our poor and homeless and criminal are desperate, go live in Russia. Thus the heirs of Jefferson and Hamilton answer us on their Sunday morning TV freak shows. As usual, the problem is money. Who has it, who spends it, and who gets what for what he paid? When it costs $40 million to create a presidential candidate, he is not going to show much interest in the people at large. He will represent the folks who gave him the $40 million. Bush is a perfect example. Since his election, what has he fought for? Education? No. Environment? The contrary. His one crusade, successful too, has been the cutting of the capital gains tax, because that was the price the corporations demanded of him in exchange for buying him rather than Dukakis the presidency. For 30 years, I have made the same proposal, and like a broken record, I shall continue. A proposal which would, I think, correct the great corruption. No candidate or party may buy time or space in the media. Give free media time and space to all candidates. Limit national elections to 6 weeks, which is more or less what every civilized country does. This could all be changed by a single act of Congress, but it is amazing how those who got elected under that system do not want to change it. Can the two parties, which are really one party, be put to use? No. They are the country's ownership made carnival. Can the united action of individual citizens regain control over the government? I think so. But it won't be easy to riot in understatement. Attempts to cut back the war budget, whether the war be against communism or drugs or the people, will be fought with great resourcefulness. When challenged with the billions of dollars wasted or stolen from the Pentagon, the establishment politician's answer is very clear. Abortion is against God's law. He promptly changes the subject, the way a magician does when he catches your attention with one hand while he's picking your pocket with the other. It is interesting that no one in Congress or press, pay attention to this, Victor, has ever opened up the defense budget and expose the vast ripoff, not to mention mind-boggling corruption. Notice how on Ted Koppel, whenever the subject is mentioned, my sentiments entirely. Government is simply who collects what money, from whom, to be paid out for what. The founders made that central to the Constitution. And they gave the House of Representatives the exclusive power to see who gets what money. But since any close scrutiny of the government's waste and corruption is now too dangerous to allow, Congress has surrendered its constitutional function to the infamous Graham Rudman Rube Goldberg automatic budget cutter. And so the corruption serenely continues and the state drowns in red ink. Constitution also made it plain that no president was ever to be trusted with the power to make war or peace. But the presidents abetted by Congress have long since abandoned the Constitution. In the last half century, we have fought perhaps 40 wars, hot and cold, covert and overt, without a single declaration. From Korea to Panama, all of our wars have been not only illegal, but in defiance of the Constitution. Now, through their Supreme Court, they are extinguishing slowly but surely the Bill of Rights with such loosely constructed endorsements as that of preventative detention, which I think 3 years ago nicely put an end to due process. Presently, the Japanese finance our government's deficit through the purchase of treasury bonds. But I don't think this will continue much longer. The Japanese don't like us. Worse for our pride, they don't respect us. They are making financial arrangements elsewhere. Meanwhile, the Europeans are forming a more perfect union without us. They regard our society as a sort of joke, good for making fun movies like Rambo and junk food, but hopeless at making cars or even money in the real world market. Lately, our corporate oligarchs have become alarmed by the breakup of the nation state almost everywhere. Since the nation state, as we know it, is a 19th century invention, I feel no sorrow at its demise. But those with orderly minds, eager to impose absolute order on others, are dismayed by the refusal of Hispanics, say, not to learn English, or Armenians who don't want to be Russians, or Quebecians who don't want to be Canadian, and so on. I think this sudden worldwide desire for tribal identity is healthy, if only because our masters don't. In fact, they have made it almost impossible for us to use the word race for fear of being smeared by their media as racist, something they are, but their critics are not. Yet we are all racist to the extent that any of us feels that he belongs to a tribe, whether it be one of color or religion or some sort of shared identity. If anything, the coming together of people in minority groups is the most significant phenomenon of our times, and it is much feared by rulers everywhere. As a result, we are now faced with two simultaneous movements. One is centrifugal, that is, a rushing away from the iron order of a nation state like the Soviet Union, or an equally unnatural category like heterosexuality, which was invented as recently as 1930. Before that, people just idled along. Our corporate masters, like their bureaucratic equivalents to the East, are currently in a state all their own of nervous breakdown. Because everywhere there is a centrifugal, spontaneous movement against concentrated, centralized power. Personally, I see this not as a sign of breakdown in the world, but a sign of spontaneous human good sense. Besides, simultaneously, there is a centripetal force at work, a coming together of autonomous units for certain shared ends, hence the common market in Europe, which will be formed under a loose sort of confederation like that of Switzerland or the United States before Lincoln. The benefits of a common currency and joint environmental action can be shared by a great many tribes or races that choose willingly to cooperate. So, on the one hand, in order to retain individuality, a healthy flight from the center, and on the other, a healthy coming together freely to make a more perfect life for the residents of the common planet. But should centripetal forces defeat centrifugal longings, then welcome to the anthill society and to our inglorious common death on a speck of used up celestial matter. Our political debate, what little there is, can never speak of the future except in terms of the past, and never suggest any sort of planning because planning is godless and atheistic. So in absolutely conservative and backward-looking terms, I shall now present a winning formula to restore the Republic to the good old days by moving boldly forward into the past. There's room. I would invoke the spirit of Henry Clay. I expected that silence, thanks to our educational system. Know not what your banner is. Thanks to our educational system, no one knows who Henry Clay is, but for... Yeah, close. But he can be, for political purposes, he can first be explained, then trotted out as a true America firster who felt that it was the task of government to make internal improvements, to spend money on education and on the enlargement of the nation's economic plant. Clay, translated in modern terms, would have us abandon all military pretensions on the grounds that we are too small and too poor a country to act as a global policeman. He would also suggest that we police ourselves first and leave, terrible thought, Nicaragua, say, to the people who live there. Yes, Clay could be called an isolationist, and what's wrong with that? As our economic failure is making us more and more isolated from the rest of the industrialized world. So let's use this quiet time to restore... You never know what's going to happen at Berkeley. Moral rearmament has struck again, I have a feeling. Let us use this quiet time to restore our economic health by taking $200 or $300 billion from military procurement, not to mention feathers from the corporate nest, and put it into education, into finding new ways of training and utilizing the workforce, and new ways of preserving or restoring earth and air and water. This does not seem to me to be too ambitious a program. Also, ideologically, it is absolutely, even sublimely, reactionary and therefore saleable. But the highly progressive military, industrial, political complex that rules us will not easily let go. The war on communism is being replaced by the war on drugs. Ominously, our garrison state is now turning inward in order to create a police state. Currently, close to 1 million Americans are in prison or under constraint, the largest number per capita in the industrialized world. So at last, we are first at something. But the administration is more ambitious for us. They want to reactivate old army camps so that they can house drug users as well as pushers. Of course, we could legalize drugs and get rid of most of the problem, but where's the money in that? Serious question. Do you want a patriarchal state?
No.
Good. And I don't mean a matriarchal one either. Think about it. Do you want the government to decide what you eat or drink, with whom or how you associate? You may not for yourself, but if it, the average citizen tends to think that they ought to be totally controlled, which is why the polls seem to tell us that a patriarchal state is really what a majority of Americans would like. If that is the case, and let's just forget about 1776 and 1789 and Henry Clay and his disciple Lincoln. Forget them all, do as you're told. Look at television 8 hours a day and believe what they tell you. Join the Hate of the Month Club. This month it's Iraq, next month it'll be Japan again. Have we really lost the great experiment? I don't think so, but for one thing, more and more of the people who never vote are beginning to worry about their personal finances. They are looking for explanations. And now that the Reagan Magic Act is over, the majority that does not vote can be reached, not through the media, but through, brace yourselves, video cassettes. You can make a video cassette very cheaply with a movie star who will work for nothing in order to explain, let us say, the ongoing SNL scandal. These cassettes can be given out free all over the country, which is the only way that the people can be directly addressed, as they once were in the 18th century through pamphlets by the likes of Thomas Paine. I got this cassette idea from that lovable old curmudgeon, the Ayatollah Khomeini. If you remember, he flooded Iran with radio tapes from his place of exile in Paris. With those tapes, he revolutionized Iran and overthrew the Shah and got us out. I think we can do as well from our exile here at home. We will also have helped create that educated citizenry without which Jefferson felt life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness was not possible. So this evening I began with Jefferson, as did the country, and I end with his great injunction that should all else fail, the tree of liberty must still be nourished with blood, if necessary, of tyrants and of patriots. So let us come together as patriots, but not patriarchs, and restore what was, reform what is, reveal to a doubting world what we still can be.
I'd like to introduce very briefly now Victor Navasky will now speak to you briefly.
And you didn't elect him, you're a senator? I can't. All right. Well, I agreed with everything he said except the part about the nation not covering the defense budget. So what more is there to say? Anyone whose copy of the nation hasn't arrived on time because of your subscription, raise your hand. See me later. Gore forgot to mention the post office as the one in need of reform. I'm really up here just for a couple of minutes to thank everybody on the platform, Gore Vidal, obviously, and all the folks you're about to hear from, and the mysterious stranger who began the evening, Bob Baldock, whose idea this was, and who organized it, and who got you all here. Sandra Zickenfuss at The Nation, who coordinated it with him. And then I want to thank all of you for coming. It's whenever I come to California, I'm reminded people think of The Nation as a New York magazine because we're published in New York. But the truth is, the last time I looked anyway, the truth was that something like 10% of our subscribers are in New York and over 12% are from California. So. Now, I also think when I come out here of the former dean of the journalism school, Bob mentioned Tom Goldstein, he was preceded by Ben Bagdikian. And Ben, as you know, wrote a book called Media Monopoly, and I was very, and I want to say a couple of words about media concentration, because Bob told me to talk about The Nation, but you'll see they're connected with each other. Because, especially after listening to Gore talk about the video cassette potential, because here's what it meant to me. I mean, I liked his program, Isolationism and Video Cassettization of the American culture, political culture. I think, pardon? Jane Fonda's Workout, okay. Well, it could go on Ted Turner's program, and you could. Anyway, what it means to me is that, you know, Bagdikian pointed out when he first published Media Monopoly at the beginning of the 80s, that something like 50 corporations controlled more in the world, controlled more than half of all of the print media, newspapers, magazines, books, the electronic media, television, films, radio, video cassettes. The book was re-released a couple of years ago, and the number was down to 27. I hate to run into this guy, because every time I meet him, the number is down a few more notches. And he wrote a special issue of The Nation last year in which he reported that everybody from Robert Maxwell to Dick Snyder at Simon & Schuster and Gulf & Weston to Ben Bagdikian believes that by the end of the century, the number is going to be down to 6, maybe 7. I sent a letter to the chairman, to Dick Monroe, the chairman of the board of Time, Inc. I really did. I have a registered copy and all that. And it said, it was a Dear Dick letter, you know. I said, Dear Dick, put away your poison pill. White Knight is on the way. The Nation magazine proposes to take over Time, Inc. Don't worry about financing. We have talked to our bankers and told them that we intend to put up, like everybody else, to put up the assets of Time, Inc. as collateral for the loan. And since the assets, which included Time Magazine, Life Magazine, Fortune Magazine, Book of the Month Club, various video cassette and home box office and other subsidiaries, since the assets were far in excess, if you split up that company, of its value, the bankers would be very pleased to lend us the money. So I also told him that he didn't have to worry, that his compensation would be at least as large as it was under the proposed Warner and Paramount deals, but that we had something to offer that nobody else was offering, which was if we succeeded in our takeover bid, that we would free the corporate slaves, that we would spin off all of the subsidiaries of Time, Inc. So instead of the editors and writers of Time magazine having to worry about Paramount looking over their shoulder or Warner's looking over their shoulder, nobody would look over their shoulder. They would get their freedom, and they would become self-contained units, and everybody would be happy. So he wrote back, and he said he liked our offer better than that of, you know, Paramount was then called, I guess, Gulf Western. He's a better than Engulf and Devour's offer. He said, but, and he would give our offer all the attention it deserved. They haven't said no yet, so we consider that this thing is still in play. Now, You're here to, you know, at this birthday celebration, so I feel it's only fair, because a lot of people ask, how can a magazine like The Nation survive for 125 years when so many other publications have gone under? And they go under by, their hundreds go under every year. And I will just tell you the secret of our survival, which is that we have lost money virtually every year for 125 years. Now you laugh, but the truth is that I am serious about believing that that's part of the secret of our survival. Because if we started making money, then, first of all, we become a target for takeover attempts ourselves. And secondly, the for-profit imperative that descends on entities that make money, they're regarded as products. And if you make a little, why can't you make more? And then there's pressure on you to start becoming a little slicker and to add some colors to the cover and to start, you know, spicing up the way you handle your copy. And soon you become more and more like everybody else, and you lose the thing that distinguished you in the first place, and you end up going under like all the other magazines that go under. So any of you who are interested in starting a publication or want to, I'm happy to share the secrets with you of how we lose money every year, but that's for another occasion. Somebody once said of The Nation that it was a magazine for the permanent minority, the permanent minority. And when I first heard that, I was slightly put off, and one might almost say offended by this, because you'd like to think that you're on the side of things that are going to prevail. And but when I thought about it, you know, I think about what people have called The Nation since I've been there. We've been called liberal, we've been called left liberal, we've been called left, we've been called leftist. Actually, someone once sent me an article from Time magazine where when Henry Anatole Grunewald was the editor, there was an article about The Nation, and in the margin, it said, the liberal nation. The word liberal was X'd out, and in the margin, it said leftist, and it was it said H-A-G for Henry Anatole Grunewald, and it's their literal attempt to marginalize, because to them, that's a dirty word. So we're called liberal, left, leftist, progressive, Marxist, neo-Marxist, Leninist, Stalinist, anti-Semitic, and Zionist. Now, again, the question is, how do you, what is your own identity? How do you resist this trend towards becoming like everybody else? How do you resist the trend towards conglomeratization, not just The Nation, but out here, Mother Jones, the Pacific News Service, KPFA? They're all, I think, part of the answer to that question of how you resist these things. And in its original prospectus of 1865, the founders of The Nation, who were abolitionists, and it makes me really proud to be here on the day that Nelson Mandela is here and that the National Organization for Women the National Organization for Women is in San Francisco, and you're all here. It seems to me, I come back to the question of how does a magazine for the permanent minority, magazines for the permanent minority, how do they exist with themselves? And part of the answer to me is that the founders of the magazine had the wisdom to say in their founding document, the prospectus, that this magazine will not be the organ of any party or sect, and it is the job of political parties to come to power. It is not the job of magazines to come to power. Magazines can, and newspapers and radio stations, can have great power. They can cajole, they can argue, they can annoy, they can irritate, they can educate, they can illuminate, They can lobby, they can influence, they can do a lot of things, and it's those are honorable roles. And so on reflection, as I thought about this idea of being a magazine for the permanent minority, occurred to me that the real fact is that there are permanent minorities who are permanent minorities because they are so far ahead of their time. And I think of the Berkeley constituency as one of those, which has been ahead of its time on issues ranging from civil rights to free speech to the war in Vietnam to human rights in South Africa and in the Middle East and in East Europe and in this country itself. So having said all that, I'm now going to give the microphone back to Bob Baldock, who's going to tell you how you can help a magazine for the permanent minority and a radio station for the permanent minority survive for yet another year. Thank you.
That concludes remarks by author Gore Vidal and the 125th birthday celebration of Nation Magazine. Here is a reminder to join us Monday for live coverage of the arrival ceremonies at the 1990 Economic Summit in Houston. That's live on Monday beginning at 1:45 p.m. Eastern Time, 10:45 a.m. on the West Coast. Up next, Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev and a meeting of the Soviet Party Congress.